table fly up and hit a wall and basically disintegrate. And what the wall didn't do to it, the glass coming from the window did. And you heard a bunch of people scream all at once. And it was like it was slow motion, but it was also like it was just a split second. And I looked at my friend Mike, and he was blown off the couch. And where he was laying, there was a piece of glass. It must have been this big. It looked like a sword that had gone through the back of the couch. And I looked at him, and his eyes were looking at me, and they were like this big. And the person that I worked for, he was a big redneck guy from Arkansas. He pops out of the hallway, and he was in the shower. So all he had on him was like the shower curtain, you know? And he looks at me and says something in country. You can't understand him half the time. And his eyes were like this big around, and they were looking at me. And I was kind of looking at them, and I can remember him just saying, "Blood." So I looked down, and there was blood all over the floor. And I was like, wow, somebody's hurt really bad, you know? This is not good. And then they said, "You." And so I looked down, you know, and I'm just covered in blood. And it just so happens that I caught the majority of one of the sliding glass panes, and the frame to the sliding glass door was like around my chair, like, you know how you throw horseshoes, the horseshoe will go around, the frame of the door was around my chair. And so, you know, I did what anybody would do, I screamed like a little girl, and I got up and I started running. And there were like 10 of us in the barracks, so there were people that were closer to the door than I was. And when they got to the door, the blast had sealed the door shut. It had actually shifted the building. And the blast was so strong, even though we didn't catch the majority of it, it had blown our elevators out of the elevator shafts. So it was a huge bomb. And so we have a bunch of grown men screaming and crying like little children. And they're trying to get the door open. And they're yelling, "Door, door." So somebody on the outside yelled, "Door coming in." And they kicked the door in from the hallway to let us out. And so we started filtering out. I think I was on the fourth floor. I was either on the third or the fourth floor of the seven-story building. And everywhere in Arabia is like marble tiles, big marble. So marble's funny. It was covered with blood. And where the blood was wet, it was really slick. And where the blood was dry, your foot would stick. So it just depended on what step you would take, whether you were about to fall or whether you couldn't get your foot up. You know, so this is kind of the scene. And as we got closer to the door, it got worse and worse. You could smell burning things and you could see smoke coming out. And so as we exited the building, like a herd of cattle, we looked over to our right and you could see just the remnants of the building that actually took all of the impact that the majority of my friends were in. And a bigger herd of people were coming our way, yelling, "They're coming after us, they're coming over the wall, run." So we just turned and ran the opposite way. And we ran and ran, and then eventually we just kind of stopped running, and we ended up in the middle of our camp, where we normally eat. And everybody just kind of started gathering around, and we were asking, "Have you seen so-and-so? Have you seen such-and-such?" You know, and somebody came to me and said, "Hey, look, you know, you need to go to the hospital, you're hurt." So I guess from the shock, you know, I didn't really feel much. I walked over to where the designated hospital was. It was really just a clinic, but they had made it like an instant hospital. And when I went into the hospital, I saw people just coming in gurney after gurney after gurney. And they were missing limbs, you know, and they were in a lot worse shape than I was. And the most vivid memory I have, I think, from that day was as they were bringing somebody by me, somebody went to lift his head up, to put his head under a pillow, and their hand went inside his head like a memory foam pillow, you know, where his skull was just disintegrated. And I can't get that picture out of my head, you know. It's when you see something like that, it affects you, you know, and you can't ever, because I knew the guy, and that makes it worse, because you know they're dead instantly. And so I said, "I'm not in near as bad a shape as these people. I'm just going to go, you know, off to the side and take care of myself." So I actually went into a bathroom and started just washing my arms and my legs, and wherever there was glass, I would pull it out. And somebody caught me in the bathroom and said, "Look, you need a surgeon to do that." So we opened a different clinic. Walk over to this other clinic. So where our chow hall was, there was a clinic established there. So I went and sat there for about 3 or 4 hours while they waited to treat all of the wounded and pulled the glass out of my arms and my legs and gave me 52 stitches and said, have a nice day. And so we sat there and, you know, got with our groups because that's what humans do. Humans, we all have a certain group of people that we hang out with. And the characteristics of these people determine whether we're going to hang out with them or not. Me, myself, I was kind of odd. Even through high school, I could hang out with any group that I wanted. On one given day, if I wanted to be with the preppy kind of people, I could go and I could hang out with them. And a few hours later, I could be with the dumbest of the rednecks, hanging out with them. And then if I wanted to go to the beach the next day, I could go and hang out with the surfer people. So I was really kind of adaptive in the group that I hang out with. So even in the military, I had like 5 or 6 groups of friends that I kind of made my way around asking, have you seen so-and-so? Have you heard about, you know, airman this or airman that? And it only took us about 12 hours to really find out who was accounted for and who wasn't. And we had our airplanes in one place and we were in the other. So they actually shipped us all back over to our aircraft and made us sleep on the aircraft pad and in the hangars with the aircraft. And they were going to ship us out the next morning anyway. It was like our scheduled flight. So we sat there, and they didn't want to tell us anything about the people who were injured or the people who were no longer with us. And so the next morning at like 8 o'clock, they shuffled us all on a big Boeing 747. And the person that I happened to be sitting beside was a really good friend of mine, and his job was, number one, an aircraft mechanic, and number two, he would go out and he would estimate what happened to cause a plane crash. So he could go to a crash site, he could tell you, this failed at this height, and this is what happened, and this is where they hit the ground, and, you know, give you all of the details of what happened to the plane. So I remember we took off, and he was a little short guy, we called him Stu. And we were sitting there, and the plane was climbing, and he got a little concerned look on his face. And I said, okay, you know, and kept climbing, and he looked out the window, and he started turning white. And I said, Stu, you know, what's going on? He said, do you see the flaps on the wings? I said, yeah. He said, they're still up. I said, yeah. He said, they're not supposed to still be up. He said, do you hear that noise? And I said, yeah. He says, that's the motor trying to get your flaps down. He said, if those flaps don't come down, we're not going to make it over the ocean. About that time, the plane just turned like this. And you don't do that to a 747. And then he got really white. And I said, what now? He said, we only have one friend and we just lost him. He's called Altitude. Because we hadn't got to climbing, you know, to our cruising altitude. And the pilot apparently panicked and just pulled a 180. And so you could actually feel the plane falling sideways as we were turning. And we weren't far off the ocean. And we didn't have ground underneath us. It was just water. And just as he pulled the plane back level, you could see the runway out of one of our windows in the sky out of the other one. And I could see the fence. You know how the end of runway has 10, 20, maybe 30 feet, and then a fence, and then it was the ocean. So I remember seeing the fence to the end of the runway on our wing right before we came level. And as soon as we came level, the wheels hit the ground, and, you know, a big cheer. He was the best pilot ever, even, you know, if he didn't do all those checks or whatever. He got us on the ground, and everybody was just, you know, really excited that we had made it back alive. And this was kind of a lot for 2 days. You know, I started sitting there, and they wouldn't let us off the plane, and we were just sitting, and I was thinking, you know, maybe life's not all fun and games. Maybe there's something more to my life than I've experienced at this point. And I started pondering on all of the things that I had done, you know, in my life. And I wasn't even, I joined the military when I was 21 in 93, so I was 22 years old. But I had basically seen and done anything that you could want to do as an American. If I hadn't done it, I don't want to do it. Except whitewater rafting. I got into whitewater rafting a few years ago. That was pretty fun. But, you know, it got me kind of thinking. There's got to be more out there than to just Jim Beam and Budweiser and wood. So we had to sit with our aircraft again, and it was like a week before they could get a plane ride home. So then they had to tell us, you know, who died, and they actually had funerals. And it ended up we actually had to fly home with some of the caskets of the people that had not made it. So when I got back to America and to my wife, you know, I had said, look, you know I've been a party animal, but I need to change. You know, I need to find Christ. I need to shape up. I need to live a good life. So from that point on, and this happens to a lot of people who have a life-changing experience, I became a Christian. And with everything else, I decided that I would be the best Christian that I could be. And so immediately, I found a study group, something called the Promise Keepers, and I really started getting into Christianity. I really started reading the Bible. I started going to whatever Bible study I could go to. And my parents were Methodists, so obviously I adopted a Methodist church. And I started going, and I started digging, and I started trying to learn, and I would, you know, go to different groups, and we would cover passages, and they would say, okay, this passage means this week, and then it would mean this another week. And I started, you know, just trying to compile all of the information that I was getting. And I started having some questions on what I was being taught and some questions on what I was reading. So I started asking our preacher, you know, I want to know more about this passage. I want to know more about this verse. I want to know more about what we had gone over in Bible study. And I found that even the preacher would give me different answers on different occasions when I would ask them the same things. And I had another group of friends who were Baptist. I got into something called Amway. And Amway is a big Christian-driven multi-level marketing thing. And the people that I was with there always kept trying to bring me over to the Baptist denomination. So I started doing a little bit of both, and then I kind of swung over to the Baptist because it seemed to have more sustenance than what the Methodist church did. And as I got into being a Baptist, I continued my search and continued going through Christianity and kind of kept coming up with more answers than I could get questions. And a few years passed, and Christianity, from my view, I believed wholeheartedly that Jesus was my Lord and Savior, that you had to have the blood of Jesus, but at the same time, you had to be good. So even though Jesus died for all your sins, you had to have good moral character and try to be like Jesus as well. And so, as fate would have it, I had made a pact with God, with Allah, way back in Saudi Arabia, that if I lived to have a child, or I lived to be 25, I would really, you know, devote my life to what He wanted me to do. And so happened that I turned 25 January 2nd, and on December 7th of the year prior to that, my first son was born. So I kind of got a double whammy. I got a child and turned 25 at the same time. So I said, okay, this is a sign. This is a sign that I really, you know, I'm going to devote my life to God. No matter what, I'm going to find the best way to be a Christian, to be Christ-like, and continue with my endeavor. So at that point, I got shipped over to South Korea, Kunsan Air Force Base. And you had to leave your family behind. So it was a one-year unaccompanied tour. And at 6 months, you got to go back to your family for 1 month and then, you know, have like a little vacation and you'd have to come back. So they shipped me off to Korea and I said, this is my chance. This is my golden opportunity to come back the best Christian I could possibly be. And I remember going there and immediately going to the church and starting biblical studies. And the military is really kind of dynamic because on Sunday, every single faith has a service. So if you want your Sunday to be slammed, you can go to every Christian service available. And of course, the Muslims didn't have it on Sunday. They had it on Friday, but they were kind of whacked out anyway. So who wants to go listen to that, right? So I would go and I would devote my Sundays to God. You know, this was like my form of worship. I would go to all the different religious groups. Some of them would stand and sing, and some of them would preach fire and brimstone. And Others would have different beliefs. It was amazing, really, at all of the things that Christianity had to offer. And in my humble opinion, I thought that this is what made Christianity the best, is that it was so dynamic. It really had something for everybody. You just had to find the denomination that you fit in, and this was your way of life, and it was really amazing. There was one person that I was really trying to bring to Christianity. And he was also a person that a Muslim was trying to bring to Islam. And so I would bump into a Muslim every once in a while in my endeavor with winning this person to Jesus. And so he would tell me, you know, this is Abood, and Abood's telling me this, and Abood's telling me that, and you're telling me this, and you're telling me that. And the guy was really kind of a troublemaker more than anything. And I think he was trying to get us to quarrel. And so I would see this guy Abood a little bit more and a little bit more. And one day, I was passing by a day room. It's just a big room where everybody hangs out. And I saw this guy Abood, this Muslim man, and one of the Christians that I knew very well, having a discussion. And I said, you know, this is my opportunity. So I'm going to go, and I'm just going to convert Muslim. I'm going to sit down, I'm going to listen to what they have to say, I'm going to gather my evidence, and when the time's right, I'm going to pounce on this Muslim, and we're going to bring him to Christ, and, you know, everything's going to be great. And as I sat down in the room, my fellow Christian was saying everything that we were taught to say about how Jesus has to be your Savior, and he had to shed his blood, and he was the perfect human being, so he could be the only ultimate sacrifice for your sins, and so you have to accept Jesus to be forgiven by God because you're nothing but a sinner from the time before you were born. But the Muslim would come back with these answers and these remarks that were just amazing to me because I had never heard it before. I'd never really thought about it before. I'd never really seen this way or this view. And so I would start thinking, wow, I'm glad I didn't say what the Christian had just said, because what the Muslim said made so much more sense. And really, the Christian was kind of devastated, and he would pull himself together and he would, you know, fire a comeback at the Muslim, and then the Muslim would have something very intelligent, very intellectual to say. A very wonderful answer or a rebuttal. And eventually, the Christian just got up and left, ran out of the room. And the Muslim turned to me and he just looked and smiled, like, you're next, you know, bring it on. Then I was like, uh-oh. The Christian had already said everything that I had to say to him. And so I said, okay, what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to ask this Muslim all of the questions that I've asked everybody else that I've only got the answer, you just have to believe. You just have to have faith. Even though it doesn't make sense, if you believe in it wholeheartedly, this is what's going to be your salvation on the day of judgment. So I started asking, you know, why won't you come to the blood of Jesus, basically was my first question to him. What is preventing you from accepting the blood of Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior so you can be saved and have everlasting life? His reply to me was, who says his blood was shed? And I said, well, you know, he was on the cross, and this is, you know, and I start firing biblical passages at him. He says, in the Quran, it says that the Jews claim they killed Jesus, the son of Mary, but they killed him not, nor did they crucify him. But it was made to appear as they did, and Allah lifted Jesus up to be with him, and another man was killed. So he said, so bring me all of your evidence that you have that Jesus was the one that was crucified. Because right after that, my book says, anybody who argues with you contrary has no proof. They're just doubting, guessing at the unknown. So I wrote this down in my notes, you know, study this, bring back this answer, because I didn't have the answer. The answer is there was nobody who believed around Jesus. He was surrounded by Jews. And when he was on the cross, he said, Eli, Eli, lama tasabbani, my God, why have you forsaken me? And so the Muslim asked me, why did he say that? And if the man on the cross said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Where was his faith that you have to be a Christian? And I kind of, you know, went back in my chair a little bit, and I'm like, wow. You know, I've never been asked that before. And so I'd ask him another question, and I would get another answer that would really kind of put me in check. I didn't have answers for the questions he would ask me, But every question I asked, he had a very common sense, logical, reasonable answer.